We are talking on these main topics. It sounds very general. These are more like bullet points for me, so that my discussion is structured. It's not going to be so general. Though I was thinking that perhaps going over some of the fundamental ideas in liberal non-philosophy would be useful, would be practical. It will seem strange to discuss and present Laurel now after he's gone and after his presentation of his own work, but perhaps it's not just perhaps, I'm sure it's necessary because it will lead us to the way I'm working with his ideas and to the way in which his concepts, his methodological and conceptual apparatus has been employed in a critique of feminist philosophy. So, what I will be mostly talking about in these first lectures will be the themes I tackled, the questions I raised in the book I published last year, but not just in that book, but also in some articles, which are from more or less the same period. When I was interested in using non-philosophy in order to carry out critical thinking, that was a project of critique, of critical theory, of feminist philosophy. So, the next book I'm about to publish is on Marx, but the two topics will link somehow, and the one will lead to the other. It will become evident from the beginning why, because I can say it immediately why. Because most of the concepts I most actively work with, which come from Laurel's theory, are actually borrowed from his introduction to non-Marxism. According to me, that book is most specific of all of his books as to how we create a thought which is a realist, which correlates with the real. Using the word correlate in the way he uses, which is opposed to, quite the opposite to the way Canton Meyasu uses the word. So it's the opposite thing. In particular, in the introduction to non-philosophy, you could see, I could see the most practical, the most, let's call it practical, how it works, use of his concepts. For example, the procedures of cloning, it's explained in philosophy and non-philosophy, it's explained in the ethics of the stranger, it's explained in theory of the stranger, in many books, but in the introduction to non-Marxism, it's most specific. It's almost concrete how that works, the procedure of cloning. So I don't know how many of you, some of you are very well familiar with his non-philosophy and the earlier stages before his non-standard phase, or before the phase in which quantum theory entered non-philosophy. Otherwise, you can say non-standard philosophy also about non-philosophy. he usually conflates the quantum phase with the non-standard philosophy phase. But this quantum phase also means that he is revaluing, let's say, his previous stages, and now his choice is to use, also referring to the previous stages of his theory, as to non-standard philosophy, not non-philosophy exclusively, or he uses that term as well because it's his term and it has marked most of his opus, but he avoids that one. So what is important to recap from non-philosophy in order to arrive to what I've been doing in The Cut of the Real? The following. First of all, the principle of philosophical sufficiency. That is something which can be employed as a critical tool in order to rethink, unravel perhaps, or recreate possibilities for a realist thought in a strand of thinking, in a strand of philosophy that does not necessarily have to be realist. So what do I mean by that? Endorsing this critique of Laurel that all philosophy suffers from the principle of philosophical sufficiency. Endorsing this critique and employing it on post-structuralist feminist philosophy, I am trying to identify those gestures of thought or those founding tenets in post-structuralist feminist philosophy, especially in the philosophy of the subject, of subjectivity, and do away with this tendency, simply remove the gesture, and you cannot remove the traces of the gesture, but you can remove the tendency to be philosophically sufficient. So what does that mean, the principle of philosophical sufficiency? Something he may have touched upon in his lectures, but I'm not sure whether he did and how much, to what extent he did it, and how clear it was. The principle of philosophical sufficiency consists in the following, and it entails also the problem of the so-called amphibology in Laurel. The principle of philosophical sufficiency is something which defines all philosophy, according to him. Now, he has been accused on many occasions of generalizing too much, pretentious generalization of philosophy, considering that there are many philosophies. That there are so many philosophies that it is impossible to reduce them to one single definition, to reduce them to one thing. It's a heterogeneous thing, a heterogeneous phenomenon. But what he does is not a procedure of generalization, but quite to the contrary, of radicalization of the concept. So what he proposes is a minimal definition of what philosophy is, rather than maximal one expanded to such an extent in order to embrace all of the philosophies. So yeah, this is one of the crimes he has always been accused of, to speak of philosophy in general, to define philosophy in general as this or that, even science as such, as if that was a disregard of the heterogeneity inside of the history of philosophy. His main proposition is the following. this one might sound a little bit Foucauldian, but one of the idea is that philosophy is just a cultural, civilizational invention, one which pertains to Western, not just literally Western, European, let's say, history. He sometimes calls it the Greco-Judaic history of thought. And his goal is not to to be anti-Semitic. He has been accused of that when he identifies certain layers as Jewish, for example. He does that also with certain layers, layers which he calls Greek. He's just historicizing the phenomenon. So philosophy is a contingent thing. It's a historical invention. There is no such thing that as philosophy which would be universal, which would be a universal phenomenon relevant for entire humanity and history of humanity. Now, that's not explicitly said in his work, but that is something one can derive or conclude precisely because he historicizes the phenomenon, precisely because this is just one of the forms of the thought, of thought. It's not it's not the the most superior one. Even when he says that science is superior, science is more adequate, science is more correct in terms of conveying the truth about the real or about the reality. Even when he says that, it's against again not about superiority. He never builds up an edifice out of any conceptual material. He, quite to the contrary, he minimizes everything, and he looks for the minimal definition. And the minimal definition is something we arrived to through the determination in the last instance. So, through these procedures, one is enabled to do away with sanctity, with the sanctity of philosophy as such, of philosophy in general, or with a certain school of thought, and attempt to create a realist theory about a subject. What enables that realism? And why is that realism? And what do we arrive to through that? If you know, this question pops up immediately. If I'm attempting to create a theory ex nihilo without referring to any theoretical tradition, am I just improvising? Am I inventing something allegedly ex nihilo out of nothing without a history? Whereas, of course, there is a history of concepts that and traditions of thinking that I'm, in fact, employing. So, is this not perhaps a naive attempt? This would be the first question. If one employs, but one also has to reinvent and add something of one's own to the methodological apparatus provided by non-philosophy, it will not be that. Because a non-philosophy enables you to think in very, it pushes you to insist on thinking in rigorous terms, and it has offered a conceptual apparatus, yes, from which one devises a methodological approach, which enables this rigor, which creates the rigor. In what way? In the following way. One remains inside philosophy. This is why it's called non-philosophy. The non is about taking certain distance from philosophy as a closed universe, self-sufficient, like in the principle of sufficiency, universe, sort of recreating a certain reality, acts as if it was, and in the stead of the real and reality, this universe of thought, which behaves as if it were the reality, and asks from us to treat it as the reality. So this is the tendency in the principle of philosophical sufficiency, and this is what the non-philosophy or non-standard philosophy, referring to quantum theory or not, regardless of that, I insist that one does not have to endorse the quantum phase, because the quantum phase is already in line with what he has been writing about previously. So if it is an addition or expansion to what he, not a correction to what he has written previously, you can choose not to employ concepts from that one. Because it's not a correction of the previous one. He is not distancing himself from anything previously. It's not like the early and late Marx. It's not an epistemological shift. It's actually on some axis of continuity. So if that's the case, and that is the case, that is his attitude toward this development, one can really decide to just work with the concepts that are, you know, more adequate, perhaps, for your own research. So going back to philosophy and philosophical self-sufficiency, and to the non and non-philosophy. And to the main question, it's all related to the question, it's not the main question, but the one we departed from a few minutes ago. How do we avoid improvisation? How do we avoid arbitrariness when we start our own realist project, rejecting history of philosophy as relevant for us? How do we not fall into that trap of commonsensical improvisation? How does it still remain theory? Well, it does, because we are still in philosophy, we still work with philosophy, we just undertake several basic procedures which enables us to establish this realist stance, suspend the principle of philosophical sufficiency, and carry out a thought that would be called a thought of dualysis. And this dualysis, this procedure of dualysis, produces these clones, conceptual clones. I will explain the procedure. Now, the principle of philosophical sufficiency. It's about the following. He says that all philosophy is defined by the founding gesture of deciding in advance, really in advance, literally, even temporally in advance, as to what the real is. Not just the reality, what the real is. That there is always, this is what defines philosophy, there is always a conflation between truth and the real. Hence, philosophy starts from, and what's the cornerstone of philosophy, any philosophy? The being. And what's the being if not this amphibology, this, what would be the amphibology, sort of a hybridization in which the two parts try to act as one, hybridization which is not admitted as such, of the real and truth. And this is the defining characteristic of all philosophy. And he insists that even when, even after the linguistic turn, when there is this declared commitment to do away with metaphysics, to leave aside the grand questions of the truth, also the real, that's the point when we abandon the attempt to think the real. The real is declared inaccessible, so we do not thinking. We just leave it as something which is not subject to thought or theory. So even there you have the same tendency, according to him, which is the amphibological tendency. That amphibological tendency is just another explanation of how the principle of philosophical sufficiency works. And so even there you have the same thing. If you decide that, you know, following Lacan, that the real is inaccessible to thought, hence we are just thinking linguistic constructs, discursive constructs, and this is the only real we are interested in, we can account for theoretically, philosophical, etc., 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 while assuming that there is some real outside, out there, but we are not touching it because it's just something inaccessible to us. That means that philosophy has decided what will be recognized as the real. So we have the same equation between truth as and the real. Just remember Greek philosophy, and let's just think until nowadays, until Deleuze, we will notice the same thing. So there is the real, and there is truth about the real, and let's take Greek philosophy, let's take theology, which is, according to me, past a part of the history of philosophy. It's nothing distinct. So the more truthful something is, the more it's the truth about existence, about the substance, about the usia of the universe, the more it represents the truth, the more it's real. The less it makes sense, it's not the real, it's not real. If we just think back of, you know, the language of the history of philosophy, this is something which keeps reoccurring. Let's take Deleuze, the immanence, you know. Not only it is an interpretation of the world, but it is also an ontological postulation. What the world is, what the existence is, it's all the immanence. Again, what is the real, which would be the adequate, the right way to, position oneself toward the real, would be to be close to the immanence, to be an affirmation, a yes, the big yes, to the immanence, like in the repetition and difference So there is this thing, it's not just a postulate, like a, you know, I don't know, an epistemological thing, a cognitive thing. This is how I interpret the real or the reality I encounter. It's also, this is the reality, this is the real, and it is also not a talk of a certain particular reality, like in the sciences. I don't know, I decide to explain why, what those waves in the lake are. In science you have fragmental knowledge, and I choose to explain that, or I choose to explain the moon. In philosophy, out of the explanation of the moon, I'm explaining the entire universe. I'm explaining the most abstract question of what the real is, and I'm also disciplining one's attitude as to how the attitude toward the reality. So there is this is the decisionism in philosophy that Laurel criticizes. So these are of course theories, ideas there in his thought that I have been interested in and using in order to reread feminist philosophy and find a realist kernel there. I cannot guarantee 100% that all I'm saying is all he really meant to say. I think that that I've understood the core of it correctly, what I've been presenting so far, although I may have added something of my own, but it's also, as I said in the beginning, a very impoverished conceptual in the good sense, in the sense of reducing to the minimum of philosophy in there and arriving to some theoretical skeleton, or not just a skeleton, it's a whole apparatus, it's like conceptual structure, which is also mobile, but it's very minimal in terms of philosophy. So I've borrowed some of that and structured it according to the subject of my study, which was feminist philosophy. So repeating once again, the non-philosophy is about working with philosophy while doing away with certain principles which are defining of philosophy as a self-sufficient phenomenon, as a project which has done away with the principle of philosophical sufficiency. That one, I think I have explained, with the tendency, coming down to the tendency of the of amphibology. So this tendency of sorry, I've been smoking too much. So this tendency of philosophy of thought acting instead of the real, postulating not just a certain truth about the real, but postulating a real. So introducing philosophy in such way as if it should replace the real, act in its stead, because it's more there is more truth to it. It's more there is more truth to it. That would be enough. So recognizing this, employing this critical procedure, one can still work with authors like Judith Butler or Rosie Bradotti, Lizzie Rigore, those I've been working with in the cut of the real, while carrying out this procedure of doing away with philosophical sufficiency. When one does that, the next move and the purpose of doing that is establishing a realist thought, a thought correlating with the real, as Lorel would say. So what's this correlation with the real? It's the following. It is accepted, and this acceptance comes from the acceptance of the Lacanian psychoanalysis, but there is which has immediately been sort of shifted to, which has undergone an immediate non-Euclidean shift, as Lorel would say, and turning it into something slightly different. So, coming from Lacan, the concept of the real in non-philosophy is also something which does not make sense in itself, which is directly inaccessible. But unlike Lacan and unlike the post-structuralists who have just declared the real unthinkable because it evades meaning, because it's indifferent to meaning, it does not mean that we should not think it or that it's impossible to think it. After all, there should be some admittance there that we all do theory or philosophy because we attempt to explain a certain reality. And we do not have some previous knowledge of what this reality is. Actually, we're in total blindness about this reality. There is some effect upon us coming from a certain reality which sort of invites us to create knowledge about it, to explain it. Now, the philosophical pretension would be to not just explain it, to exhaust its full meaning to the extent that we annihilate this real which disturbs us, because it just evades, in the last instance it evades meaning, and to see to arrive to this sterility where this meaningless vulgar real, because it evades meaning, is substituted with pure meaning, and that's the real. That's the real real. And here is the tautology, and you know, the founding tautology of all philosophy, arriving to a real which is more real than the real itself, because the real itself is not perfect and makes no sense. So here we can notice what is different from the entire history of philosophy. The real does not make sense. The real is meaningless. It's prelingual. And at this point we can say, okay, this is Lacan. But no, it's not. Because in Lacan's gesture to declare the real as philosophically, theoretically irrelevant because it escapes meaning in the last instance, or signification in the last instance, that would be another philosophical move which Lorel terms a Nietzschean romantic move. It's the Nietzschean romantic move, which is la fuite en avance, the escape in advance. So we escape just in advance this question, but we are still within the same equation. He says, if you say the real is meaningless, so hence there is no real, hence there is just thought, it means that with regard to metaphysics, this is a critique of the linguistic turn, which he dates back to Nietzsche, actually. Nietzsche, Heidegger, Wittgenstein, and thereon, till Derrida. This is, he says, we could put Lacan there as well, or I'm not sure that Lacan himself quite belongs there. The Lacanian legacy, the post-structuralist interpretation of Lacan. So now this in brackets, according to me, and in that little book of mine I've tried to explain, that, I think that Lacan is actually closer to Laurel than to his interpreters. I think he is more a realist than those who have interpreted him. But okay, that's another question. So it's not Lacan's real, it's the Lacanian real, which is different from Laurel's real. So it remains meaningless. It remains outside of meaning. It's definitely prelingual. Any knowledge, you know, knowledge itself, thought, is a work of language. It's a, and the real is prelingual. So if that's the case, then the real is outside the realm of our production of signification. It's prelingual, so it's, let's say, meaningless. But unlike the post-structuralist, we're completely leaving aside the previous history of philosophy, Laurel proposes that we think the real. We're coming back to the same point. How do we think the real? By correlating with it. How do we correlate with the real? So here is the methodology, which I'm already presenting it, which sort of preserves our project or shields away any realist project carried out in his terms from improvisation. So it sort of protects us from improvisation because it also gives us certain methodological rigor, which disables the possibility of being, you know, arbitrary, commonsensical, improvising. So, how do we correlate with the real? First of all, we do away with the principle of the philosophical sufficiency. We remain inside of philosophy, but assuming this non. The non is the doing away of with the philosophical principle of philosophical sufficiency. And from this position of the non, we operate with philosophical material. But while operating with this philosophical material, our thought, as he says, succumbs to it's not just associative now, I don't remember the French word, but it's really succumbs, like, you know, there is succumbs to the dictate of the real rather than to philosophy. So, what does it mean practically? We work with thought, but we succumb to the dictate of the real rather than to philosophy. Well, we succumb to the dictate of the real in the sense that that real is supposed to be outside philosophy. So it's not a real which is like this or which is like that, which is immanence, which is, I don't know what, the transcendence. It's just something which is outside of philosophy. We haven't defined it philosophically. Not even scientifically, because in science no one speaks of the real. It's already a philosophical construct, the real. In non-philosophy, at least as I understand it, it's a provisional term which refers to an instance, to a modality, but it has no substance in itself. There is no the real, which is such and such. It's a formal category. There is no semantics there, let's say. Let's put it that way. So, it's not filled with meaning. There is no semantics. It's a formal category. So things appear as signification. We have already given them meaning. When we perceive them, when we treat them in a certain way, we give them meaning. We inscribe them in our scheme of meaning, and then we treat them philosophically. But sometimes they hit against any possible meaning we might give them, and that's when they manifest themselves as the real. That's when we deal with the formal category of the real. That would be the succumbing to the real. Okay, let's use an example from Marxism. We recognize the relevance, let's assume we recognize the relevance of Marxism nowadays. It's obviously a means of interpretation of a phenomenon we are dealing with, capitalism. We would like to find a solution to it, but if we stick to certain concepts which do not work anymore, let's say the dictatorship of the proletariat, Jordan hates, I also think that that's just historically obsolete. The historical meaning of the dictatorship of the proletariat. But if you carry out a non-philosophical reading of Marx, and if you elevate proletariat and bourgeoisie to generic, to the level of generic notions, they make sense to me. But nowadays, a proletariat is not just, you know, workers in the factories. That proletariat would be, if we elevate the concept in, we take the concept from Marx and elevate it to, or reduce it to a generic category, it will cover the reserve army of labor. It will cover basically each body which it is alienated from itself in order to be exploited for the creation of capital. So the example is the following. If a certain philosophy does not work because the reality says it doesn't work, we have a clear signal. It's not a signal, it's a knock upon our system of signification, giving meaning, that it's not working, and that there is a certain reality out there that needs to be explained. Now, the philosophical tendency would be to fix the real to fit philosophy. The scientific tendency would is the opposite. I don't care if my edifice of meaning, my perfect edifice of meaning, becomes problematized, hardly tenable anymore, so that the paradigm, the explanatory paradigm is in danger. I do not care about that. I leave it like that, fragmented, in danger to fall apart. And I work on my explanation of this phenomenon, of this occurrence of the real, and I'm trying to be exact about that. If that endangers the entire edifice behind a theory, a paradigm of explanation, what do I care? I mean, it's my work to explain this thing as exactly as possible. So what he, what the non-philosophy enables us to do is to work with philosophy, to work inside philosophy, but in order to, not in order to be, in order to be more exact, to be realist, to correlate with the real, in the way I just explained, not while not being too worried whether this entire edifice of meaning, a cosmology, a universe of meaning, which is something each philosophy produces, it produces an accomplished a fullness of meaning, a universe of meaning. Well, the proposition is that this universe, the preserving of this universe, should not be our main task, and our main task should be explaining the realities we face while working with the philosophical material. And one of the consequences there would be, it's not just a consequence actually, it's a procedure. One of the necessary procedures, which is part of this, as I said, minimal but necessary non-philosophical apparatus, is reducing philosophy, philosophical constructs, philosophical cosmologies to material, to mere fragmented material, material of concepts. And this is called chora. Chora, how do you pronounce it? In Greek that would be chora. So this is a material of disassembled philosophies, let's say transcendental constructs, as minimal as possible. They do not create this universe of meaning. Another example, for example, I don't know, one can work with Deleuze, one can work with his concept of immanence, but one does not have to agree with the necessity of the yes, the affirmation, for example, the gesture of affirmation. Now, philosophy would be, no, 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 but it's not the lesson, we have to do it. If you, if you work with the immanence, then you have to say yes to this difference which constantly repeats itself. Well, no, I'm inside of philosophy, I work with immanence, I have this subject of study, and for me, immanence works more or less as conceived by Deleuze, but I don't need this, yes. So, in a way, you do away, not just with the philosophical sufficiency as an epistemological problem, but also as one of almost moral disciplining. It is almost moral disciplining. Philosophy postulates a reality, the real, but also the stance toward it, almost a behavior. There is almost moralism there. So once you dismantle the edifice based upon the principle of philosophical sufficiency, once you endorse this logic of correlation with the real, which means the thought in the last instance, succumbs to the real rather than to a theoretical construct or a philosophy, you have already established this realist position. And so this is already being positioned endorsing the non in non-philosophy, but you still work with philosophy. And so there are other procedures, so one of the results is, of course, let's say transcending the problem of amphibology I presented in the beginning, which is just one of the phases of the philosophical sufficiency of amphibology. This conflation between the real and meaning. And the real acts as meaning or truth, and the truth as the real. So this is something we have already surpassed. But we do this fundamental critical procedures, but then we continue working with the philosophical material we have chosen to work with. So in that way, we are also once for all doing away with the idea of the being as the central in philosophy. And it's something which is already evident, I guess it's a product of this anthropological tendency, etc. But it is indeed what materially results to the philosophical decisionism in the last instance. It materially always results to the concept of being. Actually, without the being, there would be no philosophy. And the being is precisely this anthropological creation, hybridization of truth and the real. And it's interesting when I studied, I also studied classics and Greek and ancient philosophy, and my BA diploma, it's called diploma, like a dissertation for your BA you do, was on the translation of Usia in Aristotle's Metaphysics and the Slavic languages, South Slavic languages, not necessarily just Macedonian, Bulgarian. So at that time in the Middle Ages, they were all the same. So it was on this, and I had to read a lot of philological studies, and now it's all way back in the past, and I don't remember everything very precisely, but I know one thing, that the being in Greek philosophy is almost impossible to be translated in non-Indo-European languages. Almost impossible. There is no such thing. And it's actually, you know, to on in Greek. It's really a philosophical creation. It doesn't have any sense in the everyday. It didn't have any sense in the everyday language of the Greek people. So there is this abstraction, this imagination of the being as a process, and then from this how do you call it in English?
Participle.
Dobro. От филология, факултет, какво ги памта, не е битно. And then out of that, you create a noun. And then you have this to on. So somebody decided to call it to-on, and then it started having a meaning and being also the real. Somebody permitted this pretension to this invention called to-on to be more real than the real itself, to act as if it were the real. And to me, this tendency of elevating as abstraction and of establishing a constant hierarchy between thought and body, abstraction and concrete, etc., etc., and this almost violent tendency of thought to substitute the dumb real, to me, that's the same drive behind capitalism. That's what's capitalism. And this is why, to me, Marx and Laurel are very similar. And I use them in a very similar way. Tomorrow I will talk about Marx. Today I'm supposed to talk about feminism, but I spent a lot of time on explaining how I understand and how I use Laurel. And I would just like to add one more explanation, and that is that I'm trying not to add any meaning to what Laurel says. I'm trying to carry out a precise reading of what he does. And when I employ it in my research, in my writing, when I write or research, then I'm very clear that in announcing that now I'm doing this with this concept. So in the treatment of his concepts, I'm trying to avoid philosophical pretension to know more than Laurel himself what he really meant to say. So so when I'm saying I'm presenting how I understand them and how I use them, that does not mean that I'm adding interpretation. There is interpretation. Everybody has to interpret in order to understand, of course. But that minimal, you know, the cognitively necessary interpretation, not philosophical interpretation. And then what's done more with that, like equating philosophy with capitalism, that's something which I admittedly or admittingly do. I do not imply that this is what Laurel said. Though to me, as I said in the beginning, those concepts in Laurel, which are rather, I don't know, abstractly presented, most specifically defined, are more specific, are more narrowly defined, and more close to imagining their concrete use in the introduction to non-Marxism. I don't know if this was his intention, but the fact that he dedicated to this book to one of the two projects that he has declared as the only the only projects closest to constituting science of the humans, so not in the humanities as a discipline, but of the humans, which is about the humans, which is his project. One of this, one of the two projects which have come closest to that, according to him, are psychoanalysis and Marxism. And precisely because he says that and he tries to demonstrate that that's the case in the introduction to non-Marxism, maybe that enables us to see more closely in his work as to how these concepts operate and how they can be applied to an interpretation of a certain reality. I think that all of this, I have already presented all of this. There must be time for, for feminism, but maybe we can, discuss this concept a little bit. Maybe you have questions, maybe you have your own interpretation or understanding of these ideas. Maybe we can discuss those a little bit and then...
Questions?
Yeah.
You said at some point that the nuances produce clothes. Can you explain the nuances, how it works exactly?
Yeah. Dualysis is something I already explained, but I never said that that was dualysis. It's the following. Dualysis is also a procedure of unilateralization. So it's dualysis is about a procedure of thought which affirms the fact that the real remains indifferent to thought, so that there is this grounding dyad between the real and thought, and this grounding dyad of irreconcilable duality, but not dualism, duality is affirmed. And now this sounds like Lacan, right? But as soon as this is affirmed, on the grounds of this affirmation, which can come down to a very simple pronunciation, enunciation that the real is, this is a quote from Lacan, is indifferent to thought. It's just indifferent. It doesn't care what we do with it. So as soon as this deed is affirmed, as soon as the indifference of the real to thought is affirmed, we are affirming also the fact that the truth, our interpretation of the real, can never be mirrored by the real. It's just sort of adjusting our relation toward the real in the most adequate possible way. But we do not grasp, we do not encompass, we do not possess the real through thought. This would be, let's say, the ontological core of this. But the procedure itself of dualism is the affirmation of the indifference of the real, and it's precisely on the grounds of this affirmation of the indifference of the real, the thought attempts to correlate with the real. So this is dualism. Unlike in Lacan, in the Lacanian, legacy or tradition of interpretation, whereby we affirm the real is inaccessible and we leave it aside. In dualysis, precisely the affirmation that the real as such is unthinkable, inaccessible, precisely this affirmation enables us to think the real. If that's clear.
And what is produced by this process is the clone.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. The clone would be the most radical concept, the most minimal, philosophically impoverished concept you can arrive to precisely as a result of this procedure. the clone is a concept we arrived to through a determination in the last instance, which operates with philosophical minimum and with this constant correlation with the real. Although it's he's not very clear, you know, as to how we arrive to the clone, but it's in the introduction to non-Marxism, he's almost explicit about the clone. I think it's in the French edition, it's page 48, where he's, well, it's just one of the couple of examples where he's really explicit about it, so it's impossible to forget it. There is this explicit statement, as you say, that at as a result of this procedure, we arrive to the clone. And there, he also uses at several places in quotation marks the syntax of the real. So thought follows the syntax of the real. Of course, it's not syntax in the literal sense of the word, because the real itself is outside of language. By following its syntax, let's call it behavior, it produces close, philosophically minimal concepts. And at the same time, where they tend to be actually very precise. Like, I don't know, and for example, when you use this approach in reading Marx, you arrive to the conclusion, well, himself arrives to that conclusion, that the cornerstone of Marxism is the radical concept of labor force, the position of labor force, of labor in capitalism. Leaving everything outside, we can just exclude everything else from Marxism. If we preserve this concept as it's produced in Marx's writing, we have the core of Marxism, according to him. For example, like I have tried to test that on my reading of Marx, and it turns out that in fact, yeah, it's more or less accurate, because capitalism is based on wage labor, of on everything being subject to wage, to rent, on the abstraction from the concrete body, from the concrete labor, from use value, surplus value versus use value. So this logic of wage, the possibility of turning something which is concrete, like this and that type of work, this body, etc., etc., into labor as an abstraction, is the kernel of capitalism. But we'll talk about that more tomorrow. So yeah, that would be the clone. And for example, in Marxism or non-Marxism, as a result of such procedure, we can arrive to this determination in the last instance of Marxism, which is this concept which is practically the clone of the reality Marx is trying to explain. That's labor force. So that's dualysis, and it's linked to the cloning. It's practically the same thing. And then we arrive to the radicalized concept, which does not necessarily always have to be the clones. Radicalized concepts are already some transcendental minimal construct, some sort of an explanation, some sort of a minimal thesis, which operates with the so-called clones, but are not just clones. It's just more. It's already a certain construct. Unilateralization is the same. Hora, I think I've explained that. That's just this disassembled, fragmented philosophical material. Total fragmentation of philosophical cosmologies. Nothetic thought would be the thought which does not postulate in advance what the real is, but rather correlates with the instances of reality and explains them. Here is the definition, one of the definition of non-thetic thought. It's also one of the ways I've tried to explain how the real Lorelian real, mostly, or the real, how it intervenes in thought and philosophy, and how it's relevant and it could be thought and it should be a subject to thought and theory is by a way of making an analogy, or maybe just simply use of these concepts of tiché and the automaton in Lacan, which he borrows from Aristotle. Tiché is in Greek an accident,
an occurrence.
Tiché? No. Tiché is an accident, and it could be also fate. And that's interesting that that's in accordance with what François was talking about, the dice. It comes from Nietzsche. It was like destiny is the Dionysus throw of dice. The idea is that you throw a dice and it's an accident, but this accident determines everything already, so it's also fate. So tiché, in the same way, it's an accident, but this accident reshapes everything, and you have to reconfigure language around it, reinvent language. So the automaton would be the automaton of signification, like in Lacan. We keep producing meaning, the pleasure principle. We don't stop. We're a non-stop machine of signification. This is what we are as subjects, especially as subjects, understood in psychoanalytic sense. And the real comes to us in the form of trauma, and this trauma to the making sense of the project of the pleasure principle of the or the project of signification is precisely tiché, this accident, this like what's this? It does not make sense. The real happens when it makes no sense. That's the real. When you face the non-making sense as an instance, but also something which endanger our entire process of making sense, then we have encountered the real, or the real has encountered us in the form of tiché, this accident. And then, the philosophical pulsion would be, oh, this is just meaningless. This is meaninglessness. This is something which makes no sense. So it's not entitled to be recognized as the real, because it does not make sense. So it's not there. Well, the non-philosopher says, no, we work around that, and we try to see what that was. And we create a meaning around that. Now it sounds abstract, but actually this thing have a really concrete shape. These things are concrete occurrences. These are it does not sound as mystical as now, when we are trying to be methodologically precise and rigorous, and it all sounds very abstract. But in practice, it's not. It's like, I don't know, let's take our, I don't know, activist experiences from last year. Some of us in this last year of protests, etc., etc., have been, I am not part of those, have defined themselves, were defined at the beginning as radical left, but as things started to unfold, it was so often not clear if it's left or right, whether it's radical or not. At one point we realized that what we're actually trying to regain, we used to have it at some point in history, to regain is some minimum democracy. If it's minimum democracy, is it really radical left? But, you know, a Leninist philosophical approach would be, no, this is the program, this is the philosophy. All of this, which does not make sense, is just stricken out of the schema, and we pursue our project. The other way would be, let's see what's happening, which does not make sense according to our philosophical interpretation, and not just interpretation, project we started from, which is like the Marx, etc., etc. Does not make sense in that way, or it even subverts it. It renders it meaningless. So instead of dismissing all of that as an aberration, some strange occurrence, an aberration from what? From philosophy. Instead of dismissing it as an aberration, we can start thinking around it and reconceptualizing perhaps our entire ideology. So here is a practical example how that would work. So I'm still within Marxism, I still operate with these concepts, my position is and tendency is such, but as an activist I encounter certain instances which drive me to reconceptualize my doctrine, revise my doctrine, and being caught up in the moment of activism, I don't even have the time to do that. I have to act. So, in order for so the idea is to legitimize that as the more adequate way of working with philosophy than the scholastic admiration of the perfection of the system and sort of raping the real to enter that system. So this is perhaps an oversimplification, but this is really what it's about. And while doing that, you don't have to become theoretically, philosophically irresponsible by let's say experimenting too much with methods. You still have this structure you can employ from Laurel, let's say you can use other authors as well. I'm talking now about the use of Laurel, which is in fact very minimal, but at the same time so very rigorous. So what you arrive at is something actually very rigorous, rather than, you know, arbitrary. Although at some at first glance it might seem so.
I have a question that maybe leads on slightly from what you were talking about, and I wondered if you could speak a little bit about the subtle difference between choice and decision.
Mm-hmm.
In the methods that you're discussing. When I listen to you speak, I feel mm-hmm. like you're talking about your practice essentially. Mm-hmm. And as a practitioner myself, I often feel paralyzed mm-hmm. by not wanting to make a philosophical decision, but mm-hmm. understanding that in order to be active in any way whatsoever, I need to make certain choices. And I wondered if you could talk about that for me. That would be reasonable.
Yeah. Well, what we can avoid as non-philosophers is the philosophical decision, but you cannot escape the cognitive and psychological need and urgency to make a decision. You have to make a decision. You have to decide what you will talk about, write about, research. But what you decide not to do is not to carry out a philosophical decision, postulate in advance what the real is. Philosophy would be, okay, the real is pure immanence, for example. And then you start your project driving it toward the proof that it's the pure immanence. You can have certain hypotheses you start from. You decide, you choose what you research, but you do not postulate in advance what the nature of the real is. I mean, for example, I don't know, I am not sure that the real is even immanence. I, for example, I don't agree fully with Laurel on that. I think it should be a purely formal category. So it's an empty formal category. It's not filled even with immanence, because even that would be a decision. So you must make certain decisions or choices, but you don't make the philosophical decision in advance as to what the real essentially is, and the real with the capital R, something like that.
I like what you said about not dismissing up things as an aberration, and mm-hmm. instead, like with activism and with art practice, you look at those things, and what Laurel allows for is like evaluating the aberration. So mm-hmm. you reevaluate, you make a choice, but it's not the decision to just continue on. Like when an aberration happens, you stop to pay attention to it in a way that allows you to reevaluate. Mm-hmm. And you don't need to, like, you can make choices as long as you have like the rigorous, when you have this rigorous system of evaluation, you're able to take steps that are mm-hmm. not from the original decision. And I think that makes yeah. sense to me a lot with activism also, because there are these things that happen that you don't expect, and then you have to think, what does this change now, what we started with?
Yeah, you can employ these concepts on activism. I mean, I do that because I have been mostly involved in that in the past year, in order to see how it works. But you can also employ that on something more abstract, like reading of feminist philosophy. I haven't arrived to that topic yet. I've noticed that, you know, feminist philosophy is entering into a certain phase of conceptual and has also activist paralysis, simply circling around certain theses which have assumed a position of something almost, you know, like a religious concept, gaining almost such a status, and we have just entered into mantric repetition of, yes, we are the multiple transformative subject. Yes, we are all about performativity. Yes, that's what we are. Yes, that's what we are. And you know, conceptually, it's not leading us anywhere anymore. We just keep repeating the same thing. So that's the sanctity of philosophy. And also, in terms of activism, we have become stuck with identity politics, and it's just, you know, we remain there. So you can look at that, and so non-philosophically, you operate with that. You try to, this is what I tried in that project, I tried to preserve some things which I find relevant, very valuable. I would never lose them. The subject is really constructed. Yes, the subject is indeed product of discourse, etc., etc. But I realized that we had to move away from just simply repeating them, that, and also see what's there which is not fully developed, which has never been really unfolded, but it's present there as a theoretical and also as a political possibility, and see what can be done with that. So from inside post-structuralist feminist philosophy, in particular the one dealing with subjectivity, to assume the position of none and see what I could, any of us could do creatively with that. What this none inside of post-structuralist philosophy, and especially feminist, and one dealing with subject, the subject or subjectivity, has permitted me to do is to ask the following questions. Are there some terms which are simply forbidden, really, literally forbidden, for post-structuralist feminist philosophy, such as the one, the stable? And if they're forbidden, what does that mean? That not just that they're inadequate in order to explain the reality, so, or the real. So there is already a decision in advance what the real is. It's always multiple, it's always transformative, it's never fixed. If you say that it's that some things are fixed, you're already conservative. So there is this identification between epistemology, between a methodology, and morals, morality, a certain form of morality. In order to be able to work still from inside post-structuralist feminist philosophy, but be able to subject these problems to critique, and that this critique is realist, not enter into another philosophy which would be solving this problem. So that's the problem. I have to, as a proper philosopher, you decide that you have a problem with a certain philosophy, and then you have to take recourse to another philosophy to fix this first philosophy. Why do that? Because venturing to correlate with the real in thinking, it seems like an improvisation. Well, science permits such improvisation. Even improvisation of this sort actually fixes the paradigms of explanation. So it works in science. What's the difference with philosophy? Except its pretension to establish in advance what the real is. So That's the procedure which this nun has permitted to me. Stanley, do you want to say something?
I have two questions, but they're so big in general, I'd rather ask them after coffee break.
Okay.
But maybe right now there's just this one. I thought, are you implying that there is some sort of minimal decision that is a residue in the process of denouncing philosophical decisionism when you said that you're not sure that the real is imminent?
No, but I'm not saying that it's something else either. As I said, it's a pure empty form. So there is no philosophical decision of its nature, of what it is. The real is more about how than what.
I'm sure this is like a kind of objection that it's put many times and there's an easy way to answer it, but it seems to me that this is like just as another decision about the real, to conceive of the real as meaningless, as what is outside, as like kind of what you say is purely formal, but actually it has some decisions already or some determinations the way you put it.
I think that the way to answer it is to distinguish between decision as such, as like a thing you perform as a human being, and like philosophical decision, which Laravel says is like a grand.
But that's what I mean, philosophical decision.
But philosophical decision, like the nature of it, is to describe the nature of the real.
To say that the real is does not be something that does not make sense, that we encounter something senseless and we cannot think, is already a decision upon what the nature of the real is. The way I see it, I don't know.
No, it's not a decision about the nature of the real. It's a decision how we treat the real.
So it's a epistemological.
Well, it's it's closer to epistemology than ontology. Yeah. Although I don't know if epistemology would be the most precise term, but it's closer to epistemology than ontology. Did you want to add something? I thought I interrupted you.
Sorry if I
interrupted.
No. No, it's not a philosophical decision. That's the point. Okay, you're saying that it's still a philosophical if I say it does not make sense. But it doesn't. When I say it does not make sense, it doesn't mean that I'm saying it's meaningless or senseless in itself. It is to me. Because I work with language. Whatever I do, I think about it. I postulate what it is. And so, yes, as Tanner said, there is a minimal, but I would call it theoretical decision, not to decide in advance what the real is. That would be.
So would that mean, just to clarify, would that mean that anything you or yourself, let's say, the one speaking, the one writing, encounters as meaningless or senseless, can figure as the real or can function as the real, can be taken as the real.
Anything can be taken as the real. Languages also can be. This is why I'm saying it's a modality in a way. It's about how, not about what. Language, for example, take I don't know. What was the divine violence in Benjamin? When you establish a law, it's a sort of a, this gesture is a gesture of nothing in linguistic terms, right? You're still not saying anything about what the law is, but this gesture, moment of establishing a law and saying it's going to be like this. So this gesture of it's going to be like this, it's sort of a linguistic, right? It's source, it's material, it's linguistic. But the way it happens is outside of language. You're still not saying anything about the new law. You're just saying, you know, you're just performing this procedure of because I said so. But the material you operate with is linguistic, so anything can be an instantiation of the real.
So
So we're not saying that the real is inaccessible and like unknown.
No.
We're saying that it appears to us as accessible.
Yeah, yeah. This is why I keep saying that there is a similarity and fundamental difference between Larel and Lacan, and this is why this is realism.